It was insane. There's everybody all around the garden, blue and orange everywhere, all the fans just happy, just like it's warm weather. It was 90 and humid in the city.
Yeah, it was.
And it just felt like we haven't had this kind of experience in forever, where it's just a hot day and you're going to a Knick game and it matters and it's a post game. And there was just a lot of excitement. There was chants and screaming and everything. And that in itself was just fun to be part of. As we keep talking about throughout the show, this weekend felt like a bit of a return to some normalcy in sports. And that was one of those examples of, man, it hasn't felt like this in such a long time. And then the game happened, and the game itself, although the start was a bit rough for the Knicks and for the Hawks, neither team could make a shot. It was ugly, but we saw that a lot in the playoffs. But Trae Young did Trae Young things late in the game, and the crowd was really giving it to him. I mean, you had just over 15,000 people in the garden that seats about 19,000 for basketball. And it was loud. It was raucous. It was everything you would expect the garden to be for a playoff game. And they were letting him have it like they try to let stars have it. And you give Trae Young credit, 32 points, but he had 10 or 12 assists. And he made the game-winning shot with 9/10 of a second. And then, of course, was wondering where all those negative chants were after the game.
I don't know. I've always looked at it as I'm doing something. I'm doing something right. If I'm affecting them with my play that much, if they hate me that much, I'm obviously doing something right. And just got to let my play do the talking, because at the end of the day, fans can only talk.
Jay, what did you?
I feel you 100%.
Jay, what do you think of him acknowledging, oh, I heard everything they were saying?
I've known Trae since his freshman year when he was at Oklahoma. He relishes for this. He relishes. Do you know what I saw last night, Al? I'm sitting there watching the game, obviously thinking about the emotional roller coaster that you're on. And I saw Trae Young's eyes literally widen up when Frank Ntilikina came into the game, has not played the whole game. Look at the box score. One minute. He played 1 minute. You bringing him in cold off the bench. And Alan, what have you and I been saying leading up to the whole week? We said, well, look, there's a history here that they cannot stop Trae Young in pick and roll. They can't stop it, which he just annihilated you guys last night, the whole game. I'm like, just blitz him. Do something, get the ball out of his hands. And that's the player that you put on him at that minute
I knew the game was over. Every Knick fan will tell you he was drafted for literally that moment.
No, I don't care.
I don't care.
You don't put a player in cold, even if he is. It's like a kicker. Like, you're going to bring in a kicker and just say, it's not. I don't even know what the hell analogy I'm trying to make right now. You can't put him in that situation.
Bringing a defensive stopper in to make a defensive stop, and all you had to do was not let him get to his right hand. That's very easy. Frozen, just don't let him get to his right hand.
Though. Frozen cold.
But he's good. Is Frank Ntilikina really a defensive stopper?
But we were told that. Phil Jackson told us
that's what he was drafted for.
He certainly did.
What difference does it make?
He certainly did.
Trae Young gave y'all that work. Y'all, we talked about being a defensive playoff team. We know you're a defensive regular season, right?
Yes.
But could that transfer over into the postseason? I mean, the Hawks got 107 on y'all last night, but Trae Young hit for 32.
Yes.
And you knew that he was going to be
a problem.
Mini Steph Curry. So, at the end, you didn't stop what you should have stopped. So, does it really fall on Frank, or does this fall on the scheme that was brought into the Hawks game?
It was a one-on-one. He wasn't even screened. But you know what? I'll put it this way. Julius Randle had the worst game he could possibly have. Couldn't make a shot, everything. And it wasn't what the Hawks – the Hawks are going to talk about –
6 of 23.
And they're going to say, they had a scheme. They were doing this – he didn't do anything. He missed everything left. He hasn't played in a week. He's terrible after All-Star. He talks about that all the time. He's got to find his rhythm. His shot just wasn't falling. Normal shots he makes, he didn't make. So that was a major issue, not having him. And Reggie Bullock, who's been kind of his outlet pass guy that knocks down threes, he wasn't there either. So you take those two pieces out for the Knicks, you're going to struggle to score, and you're going to struggle to win. And it still took Trae Young having to make a shot with 9/10 of a second left to beat them. The bench scored 64 points. Guys, this is going to be a series. This is going to be seven. It's going to be a grinder game after game. I'm here for it. This is just the beginning.
But I give the Atlanta Hawks a lot of credit. Like, you got to get one. You got to get one on the road. And they got one, regardless of whether Julius Randle played bad or not. Alec Burks was busting people's heads open last night with 27 points. You know what I mean? Like, D. Rose made a big-time shot down the stretch. He played exceptionally well. But, you know, I every time I see Trae Young, and this is unfair, right? But you automatically go back to when the Atlanta Hawks made that move to get Trae Young, and they decide to pass on Luka Doncic, right? But my thing is, Trae Young has been everything he's promised to be for this organization since he's been there. He might be a volume shooter, but man, the way he plays, it is special to watch. He's one of the most dynamic players, and he proved it again last night on a big stage, on a huge stage.